song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul.
Good morning, church. I didn't hear anybody. Good morning, church. That's better. How are we all doing? Good, good, good. It's good to see your beautiful faces. Thank you for joining us. I know the time change is throwing some people off, but we're glad you're here. We're glad you make it. Welcome, and thank you for joining us online as well. Let's all stand, and we're going to praise the Lord. Amen. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Come on, let's sing a raise. 'Cause I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. 'Cause I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. King is alive.
Hey, we're Joseph and Kristen Gibbons, and we grew up in Southern Baptist churches. It's where God called us to ministry. And we are now planting Favor City Church in Henderson, Nevada, which is in the greater Las Vegas Valley.
And thank you for supporting us in our new church in the city as we're here to make Jesus known. And thank you for continuing to lead your church in giving to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. We could not do this without you.
Hi, my name is Jefferson Hernandez.
And I'm Carol Hernandez.
We are an ordinary family in the hands of the extraordinary living God who has called us to make Jesus known.
We want to thank you for your prayers and your gifts because he has helped us to reach the Hispanic community.
Hi, we're the Glimp family from Jacksonville, Florida. We're church planting missionaries here doing all we can to make Jesus known. Just want to say thank you for giving so generously to the Annie Armstrong offering and your prayers that enable us to do the work that we're doing here, the gospel work that's so needed. We just wanted to say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. I got a lot of announcements, not a lot of sleep. So let's get to it. All right, so y'all already know every year we do an Easter egg hunt. We're aiming for like 8,000 Easter eggs this year. Something to that number. I mean, every year it's a lot. And every year I feel like the kids leave with like hundreds of them. But we definitely need your help to make that possible. So y'all will see that there are collection bins for candy, so please bring some candy. Everybody usually does a pretty good job on that. But also on that day, which it will be on Palm Sunday, March 24th, we'll typically, like usual, be having our picnic. And so please bring something to share for your family. If you want to bring something to share with everyone, that's fine as well. But definitely bring something to share with your family. And again, bring the kids out that day. There'll be a lot of candy, a lot of eggs to find. Secondly, there's still time to donate food items for the Georgia Baptist Food Drive. If y'all have noticed, which for a while I was kind of wondering why we keep having lists of like random miscellaneous things, and I just had to read it to find out what it was. But If you're like me, you probably were like, why do we need random stuff? But we do need stuff still for the Georgia Baptist Food Drive. Again, the items should be listed in your bulletin. I've seen them kind of around the campus as well. March 13th, this Wednesday, will be the last day that they are accepting donations. You'll also see collection bins for those in the front and back of the foyers and in the education buildings as well. Next up, don't forget to sign up for SWAT. I know you guys are super talented, whether you think you are or not. So please sign up. You might not think you know a lot, but you might know more than someone else. And most times we don't need a super professional. We just need someone who knows slightly more than us. So sign up in the back of the worship center for that. Next up, we have the privilege of having one of our Faith Promise missionaries, Harold Peasley, visit us this coming Wednesday. And so this coming Wednesday, again, March 13th at 6 p.m. in the worship center. So instead of our usual Bible study, Harold will be there. So please just come. He's going to share what he's been doing. And it's also just going to be some refreshments there to kind of mingle. And I think it's just more so an opportunity to put a face to like the name. A lot of times we have people that we support and we have no idea who they are. And so this is your chance to kind of learn more about who he is, what he's doing, to know where your money's going if you're supporting. And then next up, join us in reaching our goal of $1,500 for the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. This annual offering is over and above our tithes and offerings and gives the church an opportunity to support the North American missionaries, as you saw. This is just a chance for us to support those who are doing this mission work. And lastly, beginning April 10th, we'll be having Wednesday night activities for the children and the youth. So to best kind of serve you guys, please sign up so that we know, you know, hey, who's going to be there, who's going to do what, because we want to offer something for the youth and the children. And so you could sign up at church@mzbc.org, or if you see like those QR codes, you can scan those as well. And lastly, before I forget, I've seen a lot of people share it already, but we do have open gym volleyball tonight as well. You guys can come support us. Also, there is a list back there. I know me and Pastor Russell were just looking at it. It's dead empty, but if you guys do want to support in the future, I'm not asking you today because it is today. If you want to support the open gyms in the future by providing either a snack or even just like something as simple as Gatorade or water, definitely sign up for that as well in the back. But yes, open gym tonight, 5 to 8, and 4:30 if you're coming to set up. That's all I have for y'all this morning.
Thank you, Wang Ching. Let's all stand and come back and worship.
So raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. 'Cause I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. Alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah. In the middle of the mystery.
The God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Come on, we sing.
We sing to the God who heals, we sing to the God who saves, we sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Come on, we were once beggars.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Again,
we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
There's joy
in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Amen.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free. A child of God, yes I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I'm chosen. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I a place for me. So I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Heavenly Father, Lord, Lord Jesus, we thank you. Lord, thank you for just all the many blessings you give, Lord. From the people in this room to the instruments on the stage to the equipment, everything, Lord, that makes this church church, we thank you, Lord. Lord, help us to remember that we are yours. We are a child of the one true King. The one who sits upon the throne already, Lord. Help us to remember that that's in us. We have the power, the authority, everything, as long as Jesus is in us, Lord. And we thank you for that. We pray for the message, Lord, that you just speak to the hearts of those that need it, that you open up our hearts to receive it. We praise you, we honor you, and give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church. And he spoke, he said, let there be light. Everybody good? Yeah, act like y'all tired, man. Come on. I'm the old man in the room. I'm not even that tired. Come on. Just kidding, man. I'm real tired. So it's like, Wang, I feel you. This week we texted Wang and said, bro, we're going to change it up this week. We're going to like play a video. I want you to come up like in the middle of that video and like bring some energy, bro. And this morning Wang walked in and I looked in his face and I said, you have no energy. And he was like, honestly, I forgot Sean texted me and said, have energy. So, yeah, I have no energy. So, it is what it is. Hey, we're here and we're serving and it's good. Thank you for doing that, Wang. Appreciate you. I pray you had a blessed week. It's been a good week here. Not a lot going on. God has been working and providing. We had an awesome day yesterday at the work day. I heard a humorous thing this morning. Oh, I didn't know there was a work day yesterday. And I'm like, well, this is my thing. Like, if you didn't see it in the bulletin and you didn't remember us announcing it and you didn't, like, hear us talk about it for 6 weeks, I don't know what to do with you, okay? I'm just trying to. So it was yesterday. We had a great time. The people that showed up, you're awesome. We got a bunch of stuff done. The donations that you guys brought, and you brought more today, the kids area that were right there, they're all decorated and put up now. Lamar and my friend Dennis somewhere out here right there worked really hard on a complicated table, but they made it look very easy, so that was good. Benjamin donated some VeggieTales that are on the walls going to the nursery, and Sandy and Benjamin have been painting and working very hard on. When you walk into the Ark, it just so you know where the nursery is, and so it's been really cool. And so if you don't ever go in the Ark because you have no reason to be in there because your class meets here and then you just come to church, just go through there every now and then just to see what's happening in the kids' area. It's really good. God is providing, and I pray that Mandy and her crew feel supported after yesterday, so it's really good. Thank you, guys. You guys know the scripture that says, like, work as though you're working for the Lord himself, not as to man. Let's just think about that. Like, if you had a job and you went to work the next day, like, oh, I forgot that was even yesterday. Your boss is going to say what? I don't care if you forgot. You're out of here. And so we just got to remember that. We're doing this working for the Lord, right? You're not working for Pastor Russell. You're not working for Mount Zion Baptist Church. It's for God. So don't forget, next time there's a work day. Here we go. I had a lot to say about that, but I had some wise counsel yesterday, right, Josh? We talked this morning. Had some wise counsel yesterday. This is how my wise counsel goes. I send the person that I get counsel from what I really want to send out to everybody and say, I shouldn't send this, right? And they go, yeah, no, you definitely shouldn't send that. And then I don't. I delete it, but I got it out there, and it was all good. It goes with the message today unbelievably. God is so awesome that everything that happened in my life this week and everything that's happening in the life of Mount Zion, when I sat down to study on Sunday, or Sunday, that'd be awesome, I started studying today. When I started studying in the beginning of this week, it was like, God, I'm just going to stand up there and I'm just going to read 1 Peter 5, 1 through 10, and I'm just going to walk off the stage. Because he is going to just reiterate all these things that we have been talking about as a church and what I know God has impressed on my heart that we better embrace. Or things will be different. And it's really cool how God works this out. Everything we do as a Christian is for one purpose, right? I think we will all in this room agree that everything we do as a Christian is for one purpose, and that purpose being God's glory, whatever that looks like. If it looks like I'm submitted to teaching, then I bring God glory through that. If it looks like I go pick someone up from an assisted living because they can't get to church, then that brings glory to God. If it means that I play a bass guitar or an electric guitar, pick up trash in the parking lot, cut the grass. It doesn't matter what I'm doing or how I'm doing it. If I'm doing it for God and my life is bringing glory to God, then I'm walking where I should be walking. Bringing honor to God is not something that you and I get to wake up today and decide, today I'm going to bring honor to God, but tomorrow not so much. Like, I'm going to give it all I got today, and then tomorrow I'm just going to chill out. God, if all I have is one day. We can't pick it up and put it down day to day. It's every day, like pursuit. We're chasing and having to have that passion for God's holiness, for surrender and for selflessness. And I don't know about you, but I don't wake up every day going, God, what can I surrender to? Like, what can I just make myself selfless, available for everyone? There are days when I wake up tired, or days when I wake up stressed, and days when I wake up, I'm like, I feel like I've done enough. Someone else do something. And God doesn't give us that option. Every day we wake up and we surrender ourselves. And the scripture would say, you wake up every day and do what? You pick up your cross and you carry it every day. Whatever your cross is, whatever your cross to burden is. You know, there's a thorn in the flesh for some people in the Bible. There's a cross that we have to carry around. There's struggles that we take with us, but it's all righteous when it's for God's glory. And that's what we want to understand today. To be willing and submitted is the title of today's sermon. Are we really willing and submitted? Or some days am I submitted, and in other days I'm willing? Or some days I'm willing, and other days I'm not so submitted. So it goes back and forth. But what God is telling us here through Peter is that, no, every day we're to be willing and submitted to whatever that looks like. And I don't have a choice today to wake up and live for God and tomorrow not to. That as God begins changing me from the inside out, as my desires begin to be influenced by the holiest of the holies, there's no doubt in my soul that my passion will be that. As the Apostle Paul instructed Timothy, remember, Timothy was coming up as a young man to be the next preacher, to be the next leader, to be the next whatever Paul determined he needed to be. But as he was talking to Timothy, he says this, but God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, and peep this, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages ever began. And we talked about that briefly a couple of weeks ago, and we said that God has ordained our steps when we were not even in our mother's womb. Like, he knows the numbers of hairs on your head. Everything you do, God has ordained and tells you and orchestrates how it happens. And in this, he's telling Timothy, look, God didn't save you and I because of anything that we've done. That God saved us for his purpose, which is to glorify himself. And he did that by showing us grace. Grace that we don't deserve. Mercy, that favor that we don't deserve. And God continues to give it to us. And he says that, look, he's done this before ages ever began, when it says back in the day that the Word was with God and the Word was God and Jesus was with God in the beginning, like back in that time, your life was ordained. Your steps were programmed. Your loves, your interests, your things, your whatever was all there. God loved you that much. This week I was reminded of this, that everything I do as your pastor is for no other reason than an outpouring of adoration for what God has done in me. Yeah, like it's a thankfulness, and it's a praise to him for his purpose. And this week I was reminded of that as you work with people and as you work in situations, you daily have to remind yourself it's not about any of that, God. It's all about you. God, it's completely about you, no matter what my opinions or thought about the situation are. God, it's all about you. More than anything else, I want other people in this room and on that internet and out in my life and in my neighborhood and in my community, I want other people to experience that. This is my fear. I'm fearful that I'm not making it clear enough. I'm fearful that I'm not making it clear enough that you and I are the appointed ones at this time, right now, to be obedient or to not be. We get to choose. Cool thing with God, he lets you choose. And so we get to realize that now, and I pray that I make it so clear. You remember in the scriptures it says, I have been appointed for a time such as this right now. Like, this moment right now is why I have been appointed to be in this spot, in this seat, in this pew, at this church. And it's not to just be here, it's to be a living, functioning part of this organism, this body of believers. And everyone has to contribute. Everyone, SWAT, Everyone can serve with a talent. I don't know what it is. You have a talent. Everyone can do it. And so we want to be this living organism of a body of believers, serving, doing, knowing, living life together. So my prayer is this, that whether or not I make it clear or not, that God makes it clear. That God works in your life in only a way that God can work. Because what I think may present something as clear may just make it murky and muddy in your life. God is the only one that can make it clear. And so my prayer is this, that we humble ourselves before the Lord and we just beg for his forgiveness. Like to a point where there's like marks on our knees and like red teary eyes, because that's the depravity that we are, and we somehow are tricking ourselves that we're not that bad. And so what we should do is just drop to our knees and beg God for forgiveness. Say, God, Father, forgive me. This is our prayer. Father, forgive me, for I know not what I do. We're so naive and ignorant. We don't even know what we do. And so, Father, just forgive us. And the cool thing about God is he will. And it's this grace and mercy that Paul was telling Timothy about, his own purpose. So I praise God in the moments like that. Because if not, then I'll get angry. If not, I'll get defeated. If not, I will begin to question and doubt and have fears and all these things. So I trust God. And I praise him that he inspired Peter to not only be radically changed from the inside out to be used for God's glory, but Peter, he made him also have a clear mind. He allowed Peter to have a clear conscience so that he was able to write down these words of God that help shape our lives. Without people like Peter, then you and I are aimlessly wandering through this world going, I can't match up with this holy God. I can't match up with this standard. But he uses regular people like Peter that are broken, that are just trying to be obedient. What Peter also has done so far up to this point has boldly proclaimed that Jesus is him, with a capital H, that Jesus is the man. No matter what you thought before, no matter what you were brought up on, the rules, the law, follow this, follow that, all that is good, Jesus came to fulfill it. Jesus came to be the answer to the sin of the world. Jesus came to be the perfect payment for the sin of humanity, the only thing worthy. And in return, the adoration flows from our life. In return, the selfless service flows from my life. In return, the hurt in my heart when I don't see people growing is stirred. And you're like, but God, you're so good. And God, what are we missing? And so we want to pray that that is what happens. Peter has boldly said that his resurrection from the dead, that Jesus' resurrection affirms not only is he the true Son of God, but that his sacrifice was worthy. And in Jesus, we find our purpose. In Jesus, we experience this grace that comes from a loving, merciful God. And so I want us to turn to 1 Peter chapter 5. And I want us to read these 10 verses together. And then I want us just to think about us. You, the individual in this room. And it's simple. Peter's going to break it down to where he says, you should do this. And you can just ask yourself, do I do that? If the answer is no, then you know what to do. If the answer is yes, praise the Lord. But it's just like simple. I don't even got to preach a lot today. We're just going to read it. He starts out by saying this. So I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Shepherd the flock that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So he says in verse 6, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all of your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, he prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. Says to him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Very simple words. like things we can read and be like, oh, I get that. Sometimes scripture, you read it and you have to go back and read it again and read it again and then pray about it and read it again and you still don't know. But this we can read and it's just breaking it down and saying, you as an elder in the church, you as someone that has been here, you as someone that has experienced, you should lead the younger people. And younger people, you in turn should make yourself available. Peter begins by establishing who he is, addressing and showing that in the experiences of the elders, there's like this shared love and appreciation for the glory being revealed by God through his Son. He said, so I exhort the elders among you. He said, as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. So Peter says, look, I'm one of you. I'm speaking to the elders, but I am one of you. I was an eyewitness to the things Jesus did, and in return for that, I got to bring people along with me. I have to bring the next generation along with me. Because Peter acknowledges the fact, we're not going to be here. Someone asked Star earlier, just put her on the spot. Sorry, I don't know where she's at now. But Star, like, if Pastor Russell left next year and Sandy was no longer the worship center and you came back from college, would you come back to Mount Zion? It's like, would you come back? And she was like, absolutely. Because she's like she's in. It's bigger than the Pastor Russell. It's more than Sandy. Who cares who those people are? It's Jesus. And so we got to get to this place where we are experiencing what Jesus is doing. We see it very vivid in our own lives. We witness it from afar in other people's lives, and somehow we're able to block the majesty of that and somehow continue to forget that in the moments and to be anxious and worrisome and not putting our full trust and faith in him. And he's saying, look, I've been here with you. I'm an elder. I witnessed what Jesus can do. And now I want to embark that on you. I want to tell you all about it. I want to walk with you so that we can grow closer together. This shared love. Elders are important for a lot of reasons. In some churches, they don't have deacons, they have elders. Same term, whatever. It's doing the same thing. We're servants. An elder is a servant. The key duties of the elders could be summarized as being twofold. One, the task of judging and discipline, just in general. We're judging like, is this? I guess judging is a tough word, but more like a using good things coming in, discernment. I like that word, Sean, discernment. And so the elders are using good discernment as they lead the church. The elders are walking with God and hopefully not having to do much discipline when those things pop up. But that's part of it. And then ruling and guiding the people in an orderly way. In this manner, it says the elders were to be in God's service and to be instrumental for the preservation of life with God. In this one, the note I got here says, in the covenant community, and that just basically means in the church, in us, in those under the blood of Jesus, the new covenant where he has assembled us, elders are put here to lead and to be examples. Not to say, I've been there, done that. You take it now. Which at some point you do say, I've been there, done that, now you take it. But it's after you've walked with someone. It's after you've taken them to the edge of the water. It's after you have shepherded them the way that it is to be done. Peter's very clear on how an elder is to lead. He says here that you are to, in verse number 2, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. It says you are to shepherd the flock of God. It's not by coincidence. I don't think that God has brought shepherding into our conversations for several weeks. Even on Wednesday night, we went through Psalm 23, and we talked about shepherds and what that looks like, and why is a shepherd being used in the Bible as this example? What do shepherds do? Why are they so important? Jesus is our shepherd. He takes care of us. It means he provides. It means they protect, they nurture, they warn of dangers, they celebrate achievements. As we go along this Christian life, there are things that elders in this room have experienced that some of our younger people haven't even embarked upon yet. And you could go before them and say, hey, when you buy a house, hey, when you buy a car, when you do this, watch out for these things. Many of us don't even know what those things are to look out for. We need someone to come along and help and share. And I believe this, that there are elders in this room. And please, I'm not saying like old people, okay? Like, I'm an elder, I think. I'm an old people? Yes. The elders in this room have a task and a call. And I think that what I've heard them say to me is, look, we want to, invest. I don't know how. I want to go help a younger lady with life, being a mom, doing it. What do I do? Just walk up and say, like, hey, I noticed you need help. Can I help you? That's not going to go over great. But we're in community together. Like if Yareli and I are hanging out, and I just notice that she's struggling, she's not, she's a great mom, but if I just notice it because we're hanging out, then I can step in and say, hey, Jay, like, you know, da-da-da-da, you should probably heat that bottle up before you give it to Nathan. You know, he don't like cold milk. Stuff like that. And she would say, okay, and we'd move on. If I don't know her and I just walk up and say, like, hey, I noticed the way you're feeding your baby, it's like terrible, like, let me help you out. It's not going to be embraced the same way. And so we got to be in community with one another. We have to live together. We got to walk together. We got to be places together. That requires effort, guys. That requires, like, paying attention to, like, there's a work day on Saturday so we can all be there. That requires paying attention to, like, we're having this Easter egg hunt on the 24th. You should invite somebody and be there. After the fact, oh, I forgot, it's not doing anything for the kingdom of God. If it were your job or if it was something that you were going to get some mega bucks for, you would not have forgotten. But when it's the things of God, we can just say, oh, my bad, I forgot. And guess what? If you didn't show up because you forgot, it still went down. God still did his thing. But we can't let that trick us, right? God is always going to do his thing. You look around and you say, oh, our finances must be great. Look, the lights are on and the heat works and we got really fancy projectors. Look at these signs. We're dead broke. That God does his thing. It's not us. And so you can't get comfortable being like, I'm just going to sit here and church is providing for itself and God's doing this and I'm going to hold back. No, God needs every one of us all the way out or else this won't be. Either we do, what did we say this week? Either we do or we ain't. And that's a fact. And we could take that however we want. And I'm not taking it negative, like, oh, woe is us. What are we going to do? No, God is going to do his thing with Mount Zion. What I want is for us all to be a part. What I want is for us to be like, we knew the struggle, and we were faithful through the struggle, and the elders and the young people, we bonded, and man, look how we're glorifying God now. Victory on the other side. You don't get to victory by mediocrity. You don't get to victory by half-stepping. You get to victory by doing what, Sean? Quick step. You learned it last night. Quick step. We're playing a little game. So the shepherd, he provides. Elders, you provide. You protect. You nurture the younger people. You warn them of dangers. You celebrate their achievements, not under compulsion, but willingly. Not doing something because someone makes you. Not even for a friend, just to help them out. There are people that serve today, and I know they're just doing it because we're partners. There are people that have served before for me. And then when they got done serving, they were like, I was only doing that for you. And I'm just like, man, I'm totally missing the mark here because you're not doing it for me at all. You're doing it for Jesus, but it happens. And I think that's where the question stemmed from this morning. Star, if we weren't here, where would you be? And she's like, I don't care if y'all ever come here. I'm going to see Jesus anyway, so I'm not worried about y'all. And that's our heart. We got to make sure that's where it is. A true understanding of God's grace and mercy in our own lives, in Russell's own life, when I truly understand God's grace and mercy and where I could be, but where God has chosen to take me, it causes me to want to lead and help others to see that love, to see that joy, to see that hope, and to see that peace that comes along only with this relationship in Jesus. And so that's what fuels us as we read these scriptures. Elders, you're to be partakers in the glory of God. Shepherd the flock that is among you, exercising oversight, not because Pastor Russell told you, not because your life group leader told you, but because the Holy Spirit of God impressed on your heart, this is what you're supposed to do. And in obedience, you say, I hear you, God. I'm going. Not for shameful gain or domineering. Everyone's worked for a boss or someone that was just domineering, that was overpowering. And to me, that just doesn't get you anywhere. It just makes the worker just resent the boss, and you're doing things for them, but mainly out of spite. And so you'll notice as me as a leader, as a boss, I hope my people that are with me would say, I'm not domineering. The least, I'm like, need to be more domineering. I'm like way too passive, like, please do that. Oh, you didn't do it. Oh, it's okay. You can do it next time. You know, it's like, that's what I did. Oh, you forgot about a work date. My bad. What'd I say after you said that, Josh? I hugged you. I forgot about that. Oh, let me hug you for that. No, I should have been like, actually, what I said was, actually, all of y'all are off my friend list. That's what I said. But that was just a joke. And so we got to step up in those moments. And when we're leading in love, I got to be able to step in Ben's life and say, you know, like, this is where we are. And I noticed this, and let's go together. As your brother, I love you. As your sister, I love you. As your friend, I love you. As your pastor, I love you. And God's glory is what we're seeking, so here we go. And so we're never doing it for any other reason. The scripture assures us that if we're selfless and we're serving, training up the next generation in the ways of the Lord, then we too will receive the crown of glory. That's what we're all going for that crown, for those jewels when we get to heaven. Verse 5 says this, likewise, it says, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, I'm glad it didn't stop there, with humility toward one another. It says, for God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. In humility, we're able to take directions and instructions. When you're a proud person and someone gives you directions and instructions, you're like, who are you? I know what I'm doing. I'm going to do it this way. It's coming from experience. When an elder or someone steps into your life and says, hey, we used to do it this way, your immediate response is, well, I'm not doing it that way. Like, that's the oldest way we could possibly do it. Maybe just embrace it for a second. It had to be a reason they landed on, this is why we do it this way. What I've learned, though, in the last 3 or 4 years, there are things that myself, Pastor Chris, other staff did 5 years ago that people are coming to me now and saying, hey, we should try this. Hey, have you thought about that? And we're like, dude, like, yes. Years ago. Absolutely. And this is where we got to. And so there's experience in this room that we don't need to reinvent the wheel. That if we have experience and things are working, then we pass that down and we grow together. In humility, we're able to take directions and instructions. Teaching someone willing to learn and adapt has an impact on both the person teaching and the person learning. And I know you know this from experience. Many times when you lead and teach a class or lead a group, you get more out of it than you actually got the group, because guess what? You're not that great of a teacher. I'm not that great of a speaker. And so I get way more out of my sermons probably than anyone else does. I'm studying. I know I like the way I talk, so I can hear myself easily. No, it's fine. I don't think I talk fast. So all those things. But you get edification both ways. And so you got to offer yourself to someone and say, look, help me. I'm like, it's in humility I go to you and say, I don't have it all figured out. I don't know what to do here. I call Terry all the time and say, Mr. Terry, this is what's going on. Who do I talk to? What's the right way to do this? I don't know. Like, I don't want to step on anybody's toes. So, like, if we're talking about a new logo or we're talking about a trip or we're talking about a this, I'm going to run it by all the elders because, look, they've been here. I'm just a new guy. I'm going to run it by them out of respect. And in that, we both grow. I grow as a leader because I see that I'm humble. I'm trying to offer myself to him. I see that he's offering himself to me. And now we're building this bond to where I've always trusted Terry, but in those moments, now I trust him even more. Now I would even go further with him. Things like that. Scripture says this in verse 7. It says to cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Sometimes as a Christian, I'm reminded that in Jesus there's love, joy, peace, hope, and I'm just supposed to be walking around going, I'm so hopeful and looking towards the future. I know God is doing good things. And what I find is that I'm sometimes anxious and that many times I'm worrying. There are even moments in my life where I don't know if I've ever been clinically diagnosed, but I feel like I've been depressed. I've never laid in a bed for like more than a day, but I would if someone wouldn't have got me up. I would if you didn't like, I didn't have to come to work. It's just an emotional thing. And so as a Christian, sometimes I feel bad about the faith and my trust in God when my anxious moments seem to outweigh my faithful moments. When my anxious times seem to be like all that's on my mind and I can't sleep and I'm up and this and that, when the whole time there's so many good, God, faithful things happening and I'm trying to refocus on those things. I've been encouraged since the young adults came back from the trip. I don't know what y'all did on this little Koinonia trip, but whatever the Holy Spirit did in y'all has been a positive impact on me, roundabout, through people. Because there's people that went on that trip that I will say, hey, da-da-da-da, and they quickly turned me back into a positive direction. I don't know what happened, because before they left, we were on the same team of complaining. But when they came back, they're on the good guy team, and I love it. I need somebody on that team, because I'll quickly draw you to the dark side. I need someone on the good side, so you guys did well. And the Holy Spirit is working, because look, I need you as much as you need me. Like, I can get up here and preach the message and bring it to you, but I'm telling you, everything I say, I struggle with maybe even more than you do. And so we need each other. I need you to hold me accountable. I need to be able to tell you, look, I'm disappointed you weren't there yesterday, not because I'm like anybody, just because I like hanging out. We got there yesterday, and listen, I'm telling you, it's a thing when not the pastor's the one saying it, okay? When, like, other people come to me at an event and say, where's everybody at? That makes me feel some type of way, because I'm also asking, where's everybody at? And, you know, it's like a thing. So we just want to cast all your anxieties on him. He cares for you. And I got to remember that. Like, he didn't just put me out there and let things happen because he was, like, punishing me. He cares for me. Like, he wants my life to be glorifying and edifying to him. So God has a plan. The scripture lets me know that in my anxious moments, when they outweigh my faithful moments, I can bring all those things to the foot of the cross. It's offered every week. And Jesus isn't condemning me. He loves me. He encourages me. He hears me. And then he sets my mind back on the things that redirect my life to what? His path. John 3:17, we like to skip John 3:17 because we all like to know we can quote John 3:16. But John 3:17 says, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn it, but in order that the world might be saved through him. So Jesus is not condemning you when you have fear, when you have anxiety, when you have doubts. Jesus is not saying, well, shame on you. You know, you're out of my circle. Jesus is saying, no, that this is why I'm here, because you are a fearful being. You are an anxious person. You are a sinful thing. Like, I'm here because I'm the only thing that can make you holy and righteous. So he's not here to condemn us. He's here to free us. He's here to save us. He's here to make our dark days have hope, because we know that Jesus wins in the end. God isn't sending people into your life for you to condemn them, but to lovingly remind them that God has set a standard, and we're to try to live up to that standard. Verse 8 says this, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, he says, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you into eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. The evil one doesn't just mess things up a little bit. It says the evil one wants to devour you. He wants to devour your relationships. He wants to devour your self-confidence. He wants to devour your mental health. And he wants to do all that just to get your heart off of what God has your heart focused on. He wants to hit you in your low spot and just devour every bit of you and make you give up. He never attacks you in your strong spots. He never attacks you when you're just, like, in the right presence of your friends that are Christian, you're hanging out, and, you know, we're vibing together and trying to glorify God together. No, but just drift from the circle for a day or two. Drift from your friends because you are mad about some nonsense for a little bit, and watch how the devil will creep in. Watch how your mind begins to wander off and, do they really love me? Did they ever love me? Da 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 da. And before you know it, you've talked yourself into all these things, and the devil is devouring what God is creating. All of this to get your heart off the things that God has your mind centered on. The evil one wants you to be focused on your anxieties. The evil one wants you to be focused on your doubts. He wants you to be focused on your fears. He wants you to look around and say, can God really do what God can do? Because guess what? The whole time you're going, can he? You're not going, he can. Let me tell you how he can. As I'm going around going, woe is me, this person didn't show up, and whatever, someone texted me this, why don't you just appreciate the ones that did? And I was like, well, that's a good text. Facts. Everyone that was there, did I text you, like, right after that? Absolutely. The text you got from me was not from me. It was from the Holy Spirit through another person. And that's how God works. He wants to distract us, guys, and it's easy to get distracted, and he wants us to think, woe is us, and it's not going to happen, and where are the finances going to come from, and does anyone in this community look for Jesus? Are we ever going to see victory? And the answer is yes. We've already seen it, and it's in the person of Christ. And what we're called to do is remember that, to remember that apart from him, we're not here, that apart from Christ, our lives are not what they appear today, that apart from Christ, along with being super tired today, you would be super lost. And you'd be super achy. Your body would be deteriorating. Because the scripture says, when I hid my sin, I wasted away. So you would just be breaking down from the inside out and wondering, what is going on? And Jesus is here to redeem us. Jesus is here to restore us. He's here to make the days that are bad, maybe not perfect, but manageable. Because he's with us. He loves us. The scripture said, he cares for you. If the evil one can get us distracted for even 1 minute, then that's one less minute that you and I are living surrendered to the Lordship of Christ. If he can distract us for 1 minute, that's 60 seconds out of a day that your life was not devoted to the Lordship of Christ. And what does that call you to do? Go repent. Even for 60 seconds. God, forgive me because of this 60 seconds. Could have been a life-changing moment for someone in my life, but I was worried about this. I was not focused on you. And so we got to remember that. Because remember this, in Jesus there is no defeat. In Jesus there is no fear. The evil one can prowl around our campus all day long, and I pray that what he finds are surrendered souls, elders shepherding the flock, defending us, guarding for us, protecting us. In the foyers, we have elders that shepherd our flock each week. And I'll be very transparent with you. When I was a young pastor, now I'm an old pastor, when I was a young pastor, it used to irk me that they didn't always come into the church, that they always stayed in the foyer. I'm like, well, why don't they ever come in here? Like, they need to be in here. They're doing what God told them to do. They are shepherding the flock from that spot. And guess what? If some rando comes in that door, guess where they're not coming? In these doors. If some person just wanders in off the streets and you and I are in here just enjoying our beautiful morning and they're not there, then there's danger and they're out there protecting us from that danger. And so that's just like a physical example of what the elders are supposed to be doing. And so young people, others, I'm trying to look over here and see if I see any young people. Starts there. You guys? Sorry, we just didn't fit the category. I was trying to get us in there, but we didn't. We got to offer ourselves. We got to go to people and say, look, I know we don't really know each other well, but I've noticed that you've been at Mount Zion probably longer than I've lived in Georgia. So can we just go to lunch? Can we just go, like, get coffee? Can we just go to Starbucks? Can we hang out? Can we go, whatever? And in those moments, relationships begin to happen, and now I know you. And now I don't look over here and go, I wonder who the blonde girl is on the back there. I wonder who that is. It's Stephanie, by the way. Everybody's trying to cut their eyes, like, who would that be? I can just look and be like, oh, hey, Stephanie. Gigi's back here, and last week I saw Gigi. I was like, look, I know your name. It's like this long. How do I say it? And she's like, just call me Gigi. I will never forget. Dennis walked in yesterday, and Dennis, I have to be very honest in front of you. I'm terrible with names, right? So I didn't remember their name as soon as they walked in. So I played it off really well. I said, remind everybody what y'all's names are. They don't even know, and I know. Anyways, he said, this is who we are. That when we're together, those things just happen. And the more we do that, the closer we are and the stronger the bonds are and the more we're willing and submitted and the more the elders are training the younger and the younger people are relying on the elders. And look, here we are, being the church. And where people are being the church, God is glorified. And where God is glorified, we're edified and we're lifted up and we're, let me just go one more eyed, we're sanctified, we're set apart. And that's what we're called to be. The song says this, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. Because that's it. There is nothing else. So I surrender it all to him. And to him I freely give of everything. My finances, my time, my energy, my effort, my calendars, my likes, my dislikes. I give it all to him. And then I cry out with a very repentant heart, God, make me content because I know that I will not be. I know that my answers that I want you to say are different than what you're going to say to me. I know my situation is going to look different than what I want it to be. But God, you know what I need. And so God, make me content. And as God begins to do this work in you and you're content with where he has you, then you begin to flourish right where he planted you. You begin to see the hand of God working in your life and you're not wondering, God, why did you leave? Remember the people walking through the desert were like, we should have just stayed in captivity. At least we got fed. At least we had a place to sleep. You got us out here. We're all going to die. And it's like, no, God's going to provide. Like, just keep going. Don't you understand there's freedom in Jesus? Yeah, your sin feels good, and yes, there's no standard to meet, and you can just bask in your depravity over and over and over, but yeah, it's just short-lived, and your body wastes away, and you weren't created for that. You were created for holiness. You were created for God's glory. You were created, you, broken you, me, to reflect the image of a living good God. And so we're called to a higher standard. Mount Zion, this is the last thing I'll say. We have some tough days ahead, but we'll also have many victories ahead. God's power and might are not limited by us in any way. God is working all things for His glory. We're all called to obedience. And obedience can only be found in one place, in the person of Jesus. And so the invitation is super simple today. If you're an elder in the room, are you shepherding the flock? Are you protecting us from the evil one? If you're younger in this room today and you're looking for guidance, are you making yourself humble? Are you going before the throne and saying, God, I don't have it all figured out, but you've put people in this place that have walked down the same road I'm going. God, connect me to those people. And then Mount Zion, we just got to get to the point where we remember that you're not here for Pastor Russell. You're not here for Sandy's music. You're not here for Wang Chang's intro. If you are, I'm so sorry. JK. We're here for one thing. And no matter how much we keep falling short, God keeps providing His faithfulness. And so that should instill in us faith. It should instill in us a willingness to submit ourselves, to be open to God, use me in however you seem fit. So the invitation is simple. Are you leading as an elder? Are you following as someone younger? And in humility, we can do both. It's in humility we find grace. It's in humility we find peace. It's in humility that we find this, the hand of God at work. And so two simple questions. Are you humble and are you submitted? If you're both of those things, then your life looks a certain type of way. And so my prayer is this, that you would know that Jesus is above all that, that you would know that Jesus is above anything I can say or do or feel. That you're not submitting anything to this church, this building, these walls. You're submitting your heart to the King who died on the throne, looking into your broken life and saying, no, you're worth it. I know you don't understand it, but you're worth it. So that's what we're about. And today, this morning, I pray that that's what's on your heart. That you're asking yourself, God, search me, seek me, know me. God, is my spirit aligned with your spirit? And anything that's not, God, show me what it is. And the scripture calls you to repentance when you do that. The people back in the day were going, look, what do we do? Like Peter, Paul, what do we do to get what these people have? And he says, look, just repent and be baptized and then you'll be good. Because in repentance, you're running away from sin. In repentance, you acknowledge the holiness of God. In repentance, you acknowledge this is broken, but you are perfect and I want perfect. And so as I pray, that's your prayer. God, search me, seek me, know me. God, align my will with your will. And if anything else is coming back to you from the Holy Spirit, then you should flock, you should run, you should sprint, you should quick step to the front. Because God's not here to condemn you and say shame on you. God's here waiting with open arms to forgive you, to love you, to extend mercy and grace to you. Because the scripture said what? He cares for you. Embrace that and hold on to it. Father God, thank you. God, thank you for your goodness, for your kindness. God, thank you for your mercy, for your grace. God, thank you for the promise of salvation through your Son, Jesus. God, we thank you that he was obedient to the cross, to the point of death. God, for broken people that were sinful. And God, he was obedient and went. God, so that we could see the goodness of God, so that we could experience the forgiveness of sin, so that we could experience the victory over death. And the freedom that comes along with not having the evil one just devour our lives. God, in Jesus we're free. In Jesus we're able to be ourselves. In Jesus our personalities are able to come out and not be ashamed of who we are. But God, we're who you created us to be. And so God, show us how to use your creation for your glory. And God, forgive us when we fall short. Forgive me when I judge people for whatever I judge people for. God, I'm no one. Your standard is the standard. And so God, when we fall short, God, remind us that's what we're falling short of. Your standard, not any human standard, not any male person, not any pastor's expectations. That God, you've set the standard. And you've shown us what it's like to be holy, and you show us what it's like to be surrendered, to be willing to be surrendered. And so, God, we just ask for energy, abilities to do that. And God, as we continue to be faithful in this church, God, with our giving, with our time, with our want to get into the community with the gospel, God, we pray that our efforts are blessed. God, that you will work in the mighty way you can to take people and turn them from depravity and sinfulness to holiness and the cross. God, it's at the cross where that freedom is found. It's at that cross where the chains are broken. And God, I just pray for someone today to experience that freedom. And God, we give you all the praise and all the honor for our church and what you've assembled here. From all walks of life, just trying to live up to the standard of a holy God, I praise you and thank you that I do it with these people. God, may you reveal yourself to each one of us. May you speak individually to us now. And God, as you speak, I pray that we don't ignore. I pray that we don't block it out. But that, God, we adhere to what the Holy Spirit directs. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand. Let's stand.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else could take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find a way and bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you. Draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you. You're all I want. You're all I ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near. You're all I want. You're all I ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are here. Help me know you are here.
Amen. Thank you. Yes. That is all for today. It's been an awesome day. Let's all stand, and we're going to sing out the closing song together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
God bless. We'll see you next week.
Since you killed my flesh and you changed my name.